So, you own a bar, I know in town, but is it on Broadway?
Broadway.
Do you go? Do you go? Do you work it? And I ask because I have a few gyms here.
Yeah.
But I am a part owner. Of the gyms. I have three gyms here.
Cool.
I don't ever go in. Yeah, I mean, I go in to work out, but I don't. That's not my specialty.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I tell jokes in the gym. I do radio and TV shows.
Right.
Because I would. I don't know what I'm doing. But do you? What do you do there?
I'm not real handy in the bar business.
Yeah, same. That's what I wondered. When it said you owned it, I wondered, do you go in and actually like, all right, you're going to work this shift. Hey, Clark, you're over here.
God, no.
Okay, good.
No, I could never do that. I can't do that. Just because I wouldn't be able to tell someone they don't have a shift unless they were, like, mean to me. You know what I mean?
So only as punishment you could be a boss.
You got no shift today, you know?
So do you oversee or did you buy in as a partner? And you don't have to tell me all this.
Yeah. No, I'll tell you.
I was just wondering because I have the same kind of situation and I wonder maybe Gavin's just way, way more into being something other than an artist.
No. I mean, don't get me wrong. I like to gamble, right? But I don't gamble at tables. I'm like a gamble with my life guy, right?
You know, it seems a little more dangerous. At first, I was like, yeah, I feel you. I was like, oh, no, I don't.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm more of a table kind of guy. Sports betting. But, okay.
No, I don't know anything about that, but I don't know. It's a gamble with, I don't know. There's something about, like, going all in on stuff and taking risks with things. No, I don't know all about the bar business. I just grew up in bars. So a bar thing felt pretty natural.
How did that come to you or did you go to it? Like, did you pursue, all right, I'm going to go find a bar or a club, whatever it is.
You know, all right, so my brother and I, we got in the bar business in New York City. And, man, we generated a lot of money.
So you were already doing it a little bit then. You've done this before.
Yeah, we had a bar for like 5 years before we got a bar here in Nashville. So we had a bar in the Lower East Side, like right at Houston and Allen in Manhattan. And we did it because we wanted to have, we were just, you know, we did a lot of drinking. So we're like, we're spending so much money drinking. We may as well buy a bar anyway, you know. And then, and a lot of us, our friends are musicians because we're musicians. We grew up playing in bars. You know, I was a teenager playing bars on school nights, you know, 15 years old playing. You know, you get done with basketball practice. You're like, now I'd rather go play a bar, you know. And then so that was just the culture for us growing up. So we got in the bar business in New York, seeing a lot of the music scene kind of disappear out of New York City. We were like, let's help keep this thing alive. You know, we know we're a bunch of musicians and it would be nice to provide a place. And that was cool for a while, but you're just hemorrhaging dough, you know? I mean, we generated a ton of money, but we never took any money out, right? Never, ever. So one day, my brother calls me. He says, hey, I found a property in Nashville, Tennessee. I said, okay, for what? He said, well, you have any interest in being in the bar business in Nashville, Tennessee?
You weren't here at this time.
No.
You weren't here yet.
Nope. This was about 13, 14 years ago. You want to open a bar in Nashville? I said, absolutely not. No. He goes, but I found a great location. I said, where is it? He said, Broadway in Nashville. I said, on Broadway? He said, on Broadway. Still don't want to do the bar? I said, nope. He said, but you haven't heard the terms. I said, what are the terms? 1,600 square foot, $2,000 a month, something like that. I said, storefront? He said, yep. I said, we're in the bar business.
Wow.
Right? So we signed a 25-year lease on a storefront.
A 25-year lease?
Yeah.
It's that? Wow.
Yep.
God dang.
Just over $2,000 a month. And the market, man, the town, you know, the town erupted. We didn't see that coming. We thought maybe there'd be more coming, you know, on Lower Broadway. There maybe be some development. But to the degree it happened, as fast as it happened, nobody could predict that. Nobody.
Less hemorrhaging on this one than the New York one?
Oh, dude, this is this one's it's a different place.
Yeah,
this is it's incredible.
Is that why
it's
you moved down
it's
here?
It's a great business. No, I mean it was a factor. Mm-hmm. You know, the main factor was that I like the price per square foot around here when I came here, and I liked the local culture here a lot. The people who'd been here a long time were really, there was a certain amount of Southern charm, still really very Nashville Southern charm thing here that I really liked. And a lot of musicians, and they treated me well, and they treat songwriters really well in this town. You know, they really believe that songwriters are important here, which I think is very important in the music business. They treat songwriters nicely, or you know, these artists, you know, be out there singing the ABCs, you know. And so and it was nice being around people who were in the same craft. It keeps you motivated and sometimes competitive, sometimes camaraderie, and all of it's good. It just keeps you going. And we liked a lot of things about it. The town is cool, and but nobody saw this coming. Certainly not me.
Did you trial run Nashville at all? Did you come down for a few months, or did you just go, let's go?
I mean, I'd been to town, you know, touring, you know, just playing gigs, and, you know, played a bunch of small spots. What's that place out?
You're asking the wrong guy about anywhere. I've lived here 9 years. If it ain't GPS'd in, I mean, I know nothing. So if you're really asking, great. If you're just doing the, hey, what's that? Well, you're trying to figure it out. I'll sit here and wait for you to figure it out.
All right,
you go ahead. I'll be here.
I'm trying. Man, I can't remember. But I played a bunch of little places, you know, just, you know, as you're trying to get a career going, coming through town. And I just liked how people treated me here. I got treated nice, and people knew each other, and it felt like I was tapping into a town when I came here. It was
your brother
come
with you?
He had come with me. And I mean, he found that location on Broadway from his lazy boy chair in New York City. You know, he was just Craigslist-aholic, you know, and just always looking for, you know, an opportunity, a deal or whatever. So we got a hold of that place, 1,600 square foot. Now we have, and that was 25-year lease. Now we have a 50-year lease on the whole building. We're 55,000 square foot.
Dang.
Yeah, it's crazy. And we're still developing it. I mean, we're operating at 40,000 square feet right now.
You ever try to buy the building?
You know, it's a peculiar thing. It's just, we don't need to. You know, we don't need to. The math wouldn't make sense.
And this has been Real Estate Talk with Gavin and Bobby.
Yeah.
So we'll see you next week, everybody.
I mean, if the terms matched exactly right, it could work. But our lease is so favorable. I mean, 50-year lease.
Do you ever pop in there and play?
Once in a while, I get up with an act if they're there playing, you know, strumming. We don't have a ton of acoustic music in there as much as we did. We started just like that. In fact, we did. I mean, we were doing bluegrass, and I mean, it was "Oh Brother, Where Art Thou" up in there when you walked in there, you know, and I am a man, you know, it was all, you know, like that, you know, and but we do. I don't know. It got the crowd in there got younger and younger, and they were asking for DJs on the roof. So we're like, put a DJ on the roof. You know, I'm not going to tell them what they want. They're telling the building what they want. You know, I don't want to force feed anybody anything. So yeah, we've got like all these crazy rooftops and bull riding and bowling and gaming, and I mean, you name it, that's what we're doing. You know,
that's cool.
Yeah, it's crazy, man.
You know way more about that than I do mine. I mean, similarly, I was at the gym all the time.
Yeah,
as you can tell by looking at me. You know?
Well, yeah.
I mean, you're probably
I know Arnold.
Like, oh, yeah. But I was like, why am I paying a membership? And why? And I was like, I should just see what's up. And so the guy that owned it, I think he owned one or maybe two at the time. I said, hey, let me get in on this. Like, you run it really well. I don't know how to run a gym, but I can help you in other ways.
Yeah.
And so we split it. We bought it. We bought another one. And so we have three.
Great.
And it's, I don't know anything.
Yeah.
I just go in now and don't pay a membership.
Hey, man, you know.
That's it. I mean, it's just like you go in and get free beer and that's all you had to do with it.
That's a ballsy move, man. You know what I mean? You're like, why don't I just pay up front for all my exercising right now?
For the rest of my life, I want to go ahead and. And my kids. Me and my kids.
Right. So I did the same thing, man. And it's funny because you're never sure if it's going to work out. You hope it works out. And, of course, you do what I call optimistic math on if it's going to work out, you know. And this one happens to be working out, you know. Broadway in Nashville sells more alcohol per square foot than anywhere in the United States, period.
It makes sense.
I mean, right?
I would think Vegas would be with it or trailing it slightly, because but it's also a lot larger.
Yeah.
Well, so does Nashville feel like home to you, like now?
You know, the people that I know for a long time make it feel like home, right? But there's still never going to be the substitute for running into the people you actually grew up with. You know, even if your hometown isn't really there anymore and pretty much everybody left because it didn't have anything really off. There's no jobs where I grew up, you know, it's prisons.
What is it? What is the town? What's it called?
It's called Fallsburg, New York.
And so how far outside of like the city would that be if I was driving?
Outside of New York City?
Yeah.
It would be about 90 miles down the highway and some, you know, some okay roads, you know, other than that, you know. But to the George Washington Bridge from... on the highway, it would be about 90 miles.
We were a sawmill town where I grew up in Mountain Pine, Arkansas, so everybody worked at the sawmill.
Yeah.
So I'm assuming if it was a prison town, did you have family that worked at the prison?
Yeah. Yeah, my dad was a guard at the prison, at the Maxi Max. So
I'm assuming that's the max.
That's like the really
big one.
That's like the really bad one.
Jeez.
Yeah, and so there was a annex. That's people at the end of their bid. Or you know, more minimal, you know. We had a medium security prison. We had the Maxi Max. The Maxi Max was where, like, my dad watched Son of Sam every day. I don't know if you know who that is.
Yeah.
Very famous. A lovely man.
You mean, and by the way, for those listening, not the show, the actual guy that said the dog talked to him. I mean, he actually watched him in prison is what you're saying. Like,
that's correct.
Human.
Yeah, the actual killer, yeah.
Yeah.
He watched Willie Bosket every day.
Not familiar with Willie.
Willie Bosket was known as the genius killer. And there is another very famous killer he watched every day named Ronnie DeFeo. You may know him by his other name, which is the Amityville Horror Slayer.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Did your dad have... And it's weird to say a relationship because these guys are really heinous beings.
Yeah.
But did he find that as humans that he could talk with, they really weren't the feeling that we have about them of just stabbing, killing, and manipulating?
You know, it's funny. I asked him about Son of Sam. I was like, man, how do you do it? How do you do it? He said, man, Son of Sam, I mean... I got animals in there, Gavin. You know, he's like he's not nearly the scariest person I rub shoulders with. But there's guys in there too that he told me when he retired. He said I miss a couple of my inmates.
Yeah,
I actually had pretty good friendships with some of the guys. You know, there's guys in there who, you know, are a lot like you. They're a lot like us. He said. I said, you think so, huh? He goes, yeah. You know, ever think to yourself, someone really upsets you and you think, man, I could just kill that guy. I said, I mean, I guess as a figure of speech. He goes, yeah, but the only difference between you and them, Gavin, is that they actually do it. He said, but, you know, you think it. Yeah, I could kill that guy. That's more like a figure of speech, but they do it. That's the difference.
Do you worry living in a prison town that if there's all these prisons that if there is an escape of any kind, that they come to your house?
That worried me. As a kid, that worried me because once in a while you'd have a break. And it was, by the way, there were other jobs there. It's just that the prison probably employed the most people, you know? So you realize, oh, okay, you're definitely going to have other guards kids because my uncle was also a guard. My other uncle did prison psych and some other kids I grew up with, their dad was guard. And then there's other people you grew up with who their father's an inmate. You don't necessarily know who the inmate is, but you know because of the nature of the town that you are going to school with inmates' kids too, right?
So do people – now I've had a lot of family in jail, but not like a max place. So if someone's in a max, will families move toward the prison to be close to their family member in a max security place?
Yeah, they would – because there's the father is
but like once a week they could see him once a month, so they live close to do that.
Couldn't tell you the exact whole thing, but then there's conjugal visits, which is you know about these?
Yeah, I do. Yeah. Done a few myself.
Yeah.
I haven't. I don't know, but I do know what that is. I had a cousin, a first cousin.
Let's talk about those.
Who And I come from a pretty troubled family, and I have a first cousin that, you know, he was a pimp, and he'd been still a lot of trouble, and he escaped.
You got a nice house, Bobby. You're kind of a pimp yourself, my friend.
I appreciate that. Thank you. This is a different kind of pimp for sure. He was all over national news because there was a video of him escaping prison, and there was a small little hole where you would pass your documents into the, maybe not the guard, but the person working the gate. And he figured out a way to slide through it, ran. His mom, my aunt, picked him up in the parking lot. They ran for weeks. Like, the Today Show was searching for him. Cops were calling me like, have you seen your cousin?
Wow.
Like, no, I haven't seen him. So, you know, situations like that, that's what makes me think of that. If you lived in that town, is there a lot of unpleasant business happening just because you're near it? But probably not. Maybe it's like El Paso in that El Paso's right on the Mexican border.
Sure.
Lovely town. Nobody F's with them there because they're so close.
Yeah.
And they cross the American, and they're like, we're safe can be. We're close to it, but we're as safe as can be.
Right.
You know? So I don't know. That's true. The prison culture is interesting to me. I've just had people in it, but I never was brave enough to even go up there.
Yeah. Yeah, it's I think it makes it's a little fringy. I think it makes you think a little bit differently about how people interact or should interact.
What about your mom?
I saw a lot of violence, you know?
I would assume.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mom, did she work in that system or was she...
She was an RN at a local hospital, and then she ended up joining the reserves because, you know, we were just never making enough money. And she ended up joining the reserves because she wanted to get her master's, because she wanted to, you know, increase her pay, be a nurse practitioner. And, you know, by the way, my dad becoming a prison guard wasn't like, hey, I want to be a prison guard. He was trying to be a local contractor, work on houses, mow lawns, you know, chimney sweep, build tables and all that stuff, you know. So we go out and help him here and there. And, you know, if you wanted help, yeah, we'll go out and, you know, hang drywall, whatever. And so when he became a prison guard, that was like being a millionaire compared to how we were living.
And probably benefits too, right? I mean,
got benefits. Yeah. You got medical, dental, whatnot. And so that was a huge improvement on our lifestyle. And my mom was dogging it too, man. I mean, she was driving an hour back and forth to work, school full time, you know, putting on camouflage, climbing ropes every however many weeks for the reserves. And, you know, I was just watching their grind and thinking, man, this sucks. You know, this sucks. And, you know, you go to school, and this is one of the things that really hung on me was that we had a bunch of public housing, too, right down the street. And there was kids who I knew their parents didn't work. And they had nicer clothes than I did, nicer sneakers than we had, you know. And I just couldn't wrap my head around, like, hey, where's the reward for, like, you know, for trying? You know, where's the reward for trying? You know, not to say that those kids shouldn't have nice things, but it was nicer than my family's things, you know. And everybody's working their asses off. And I was thinking to myself, this don't seem right. You know, life ain't fair.
You come from a blue-collar family, but you're here as an artist. And I have found that, because, again, I grew up in a similar way of there wasn't a lot around me that told me I could do it because nobody did it. People weren't screaming, you can't do it, because it was a fairy tale. Now, I wonder, with New York being 90 miles away, if, again, the weird dichotomy is you're in an extremely blue-collar situation, mm-hmm. and you're doing what you just said. You're living a life, and you're like, we're hustling as hard as we can.
Mm-hmm.
Yet, 90 minutes, 90 miles, whatever it is up the road, mm-hmm. that's a wonderland. Like, you're actually seeing people do creative things.
Mm-hmm.
So it's an odd place where right around your circle, really nobody's doing what maybe you wanted to do. I don't know when you wanted to start to do it.
Yeah.
But if you just go a little farther, everybody's doing it.
Yeah.
So when was it realistic that you could actually do art? Not be paid, not be rich and famous, not have number one songs, but make a living, even if that's paying your bills, doing art.
Man. Man, I'm not sure.
Did you go to New York City ever? Like, was that a thing? Was it close enough that you would go sometimes?
We went occasionally. Yeah, went occasionally. I got the New York experience. You know, you get to go to town, check it out, tap into it, see it, see what it is. But, you know, it was also really intimidating going to New York City. You had to have gas money. You had to find parking. Had to pay for parking. It was dangerous. You know, you don't really know anybody. I had an uncle living in Hell's Kitchen in the 90s. So we'd go there, visit him, which is the neighborhood I ended up moving to.
Because you knew it the best?
Yeah, I was familiar with it a little bit. I was like, okay. My brother found the apartment in 90. What happened was I played a gig at a place called The Bitter End in 1997, September 22nd, 1997. Played my first gig ever in New York City. And then we was at the bar. I'm 20 years old. Yep. And my brother goes, "We got to move here." I said, "Yeah." He said, "Yeah, we got to move here." And at the time, I was working at a lumber yard called Wide Lumber. And which is in like the Monticello area, which is next town over. I said, "Okay, yeah, cool. With what money?" And he said, "Don't matter. We just got to get here." I said, "Okay, when?" He said, 6 months or whatever it was. I said, "All right." And in March, that following March, we moved in Hell's Kitchen. He had lived in New York City prior, like 3 years earlier or something like that. For
how much older
like
is he?
A year,
you?
3.5 years older.
Okay.
Yeah, he was a GA at Sony Studios when he first lived there. And funny enough, he didn't know, like, he wasn't connected or anything, and he was a GA for Michael Jackson. Kid you not? It was like crazy, you know. He's like, "I can't believe. I wish I would have had a camera back then. I didn't have the money to even go get one of those little crappy, you know, drugstore cameras." And I was thinking I should really go get one of those, but that's like 2 hours salary.
Right. If your brother is working with Michael Jackson, and now my assumption is, I don't know this for true or not, but if you're growing up in a small town and you find music, someone has to lead you to that music, either through records or through instruments. Somehow your parents must have had something musical about them, either just their love of listening and giving you music or playing. Is that a fair assumption?
Oh, yeah. My folks were musicians. I mean, that, you know, if I was to define them, I'd say they were musicians.
Really?
Right.
Nice.
Yeah. My dad played for a living when he was a young man. And my mother played at church, wrote songs. And so that's really who they were.
What'd they play?
What was their job?
What was their special? Were they guitar players, piano players?
Guitar. They could both play guitar. My dad was a good guitar player. My mom was a okay guitar player. My mom was a okay piano player. My dad was a shit piano player, and because he didn't play, he could sit down and figure it out. Yeah. But they sang good, and my father in particular sang great, like too good. In fact, aggravatingly good.
What was his specialty singing? Like, what did he like to sing? What do you remember him singing?
I get his natural voice was sort of an Irish tenor. Sort of range, high, thin, real clean, pretty sound, right? Almost like a McCartney-esque kind of singing, you know, very pretty voice, Peter Cetera-esque sort of singing, higher than mine. You know, I can't sing like that. And he would always weep when he sang, and his eyes would run. And I remember sitting across, he's standing at the crook of the piano one day, at the house, because I had, you know, once I made money, I bought a nice piano. And I had it up at their house, and I'm sitting there playing a song that he liked, a song I had written about some stuff. It was called She Holds a Key. And he wanted to sing harmony on it. He's looking right at me, singing the harmony, singing way above me, of course, because I can't hit those. And he's crying, just crying. Not like bawling, like at a funeral kind of cry. Just his eyes are watering, running down his face, tears running. I said, "Dad, you're crying. Why are you crying? And I knew he cried when he sang. I said, but why do you cry when he sang? He said, I always cry when I sing. I said, why? Is it just physically happening to you? He said, no. Singing makes me so emotional, I can't help it. My eyes water. I can't, it's nothing I have control over. I'm just so emotional when I sing. You know, it was beautiful to watch. So it was so honest, you know, because you're looking at a guy, anyone who knew my dad, even though he liked to joke around, he's a fucking dude. And I never saw him cry, but he cried when he sang. I didn't see him cry at his father's funeral.
Was he embarrassed that he cried when he sang? It's cool.
No. Maybe it was like he felt like it was his opportunity to be emotional finally, you know. It was beautiful to watch, honestly. Special.
You guys sing together a lot when you were young. How did you become the guy that could – how did you become the kid that could sing, I guess?
We were encouraged to play music at the house, you know. In fact, they didn't even mind if I woke them up in the middle of the night sitting at the piano singing, you know. I think I overheard them telling the other siblings, hey, if Gavin wants to wake us up playing, singing, you know, leave him alone, you know. Because it was an addiction for me, singing was an addiction. My brother actually asked my great uncle if there was such a thing as a singing disease because I sang so much growing up, I couldn't shut the fuck up, you know what I mean? It was terrible. And but the singing in the house, there was music in the house, you know? It wasn't like we were playing records in the house all the time. That's not what it was. It was people were making music in the house, you know? Dad comes home from work, and he's sitting there with his guitar that he had when he was a teenager, you know, strumming. And, you know, I come home from school. He's sitting there with his, you know, his old Gibson, listening to the Dire Straits records, playing, you know, the solo on Sultan's Swing, you know, along with the records, you know. And that was the household culture. You know, his father, after World War II, you know, bought a bunch of instruments and told his brothers, I want everybody to learn how to play instruments. And, you know, and so had an organ and fiddle and hit bongos and banjo guitars and, you know, just wanted everybody to pick and play. And because it was therapy, you know, it was good therapy, you know, and had, you know, hootenannies that I had a great uncle Earl, who's a dairy farmer. And, you know, we'd do all the family reunions out there and you know, the old dudes would get together and play, you know. Nothing fancy, just playing songs they liked, you know. Marty Robbins and Hank Williams and Roger Miller and old country, you know. King of the Road and Dang Me and El Paso. You know, my granddad was buried to the song El Paso, in fact.
Out in the West Texas town of El Paso. I fell in love with a beautiful
Mexican girl.
Yeah.
Yep. He was actually buried to that song. And he told me his whole life. I'd walk in the house sometimes and my granddad would be sitting at his kitchen table. His kitchen table was center of his whole world, man. So the kitchen was the first room he really walked into once he got in the house. And he had this circular table there. It's about 4.5 feet across. And from his chair, he could see the whole world, his world, right? He's watching the front door, which was 8 feet away. And behind him was a window where he watched his bird feeder that he put together. And off to the right, about another 30 feet away, was the TV. We had the news on all the time. And within arm's reach, he had his phone up on the wall right there and his tea kettle. That was it. That was Pop's world, you know? And I walk in there. I remember walking in. He's got a guitar in his hand. And I walk in, and he's playing El Paso. I walked right in the house. He said, you hear that song? I said, yeah, Pop, I know you play that song all the time. He said, yeah, it's my favorite song in the world. He said, they're going to play a song at my funeral. He always used to say it. And, of course, they did, you know? And on that day, I walk in the funeral parlor. preacher gets up and busts out like an 80s style boombox. I mean, this thing was big, dude. It looked like the preacher should have been wearing high tops.
Like Run DMC on the shoulder,
man. Yeah, man. He puts this boombox on a bar stool in front of the coffin. He said, "Y'all know Russ loved music." And we're like, "Yeah, oh yeah, oh yeah. Russ wanted y'all to be here together to enjoy his favorite country and Western song." Click, presses that button, you know, that big click sound those old boomboxes made. And sure enough, Marty Robbins' El Paso came on. It was, I thought.
That's awesome.
Perfect. I got a great story for you, too. My inheritance from my granddad, my Papa Russell, was a $2 bill. $2 bill. That's what we all got, $2 bills. Because he always used to say, he busts open his wallet. He goes, "See that? If you got one of them in your pocket, you'll never be broke." Right? So, say, okay. So, we got $2 bills. I go to El Paso, Texas. I'm on tour. I leave the venue playing a little dive bar of a place, right? Kind of place that's so along the border that the fence to get into Mexico is right there. Okay? And like right around the Rio Grande. I says, I'm going to skip sound check. I'm going to go to the local cafe. Like, where's the place I get a cup of coffee? That's whatever. I'm waking up super late. I'm a musician, right? I'm a midnight guy. I walk into this place. I order a coffee. And I go to put money in the tip jar. What's sitting on top of the tip jar? The top bill on the pile of singles is a $2 bill in the town of El Paso, Texas. I went, "Man, this is a God thing." I called my mother right away because she always said, "There's no accidents." So you're never going to believe this. I told her a story. She said, "That's called the language of God, Gavin. That's what you experienced today." I said, "I think I did." She said, "Oh, you did."
How many times in your life have you seen a $2 bill laying on anything? Honestly, just at a random spot.
That's right.
I mean, I'm thinking.
Never.
I mean, I've only ever seen them when someone's like, "Look, I got a $2 bill."
That's exactly right. And look what you brought up. I didn't even bring it up earlier. You brought up El Paso, Texas. See, there's no accidents.
It's a great one. That was, wheels were spinning when you were telling it. And I was like, how many times have I ever seen a $2 bill laying around?
Never.
Because even me, I was trying to go, okay, maybe. And I wasn't going to say it out loud, but I was trying to like rationalize.
Yep.
And I was like, well, crap, man, I've never seen a $2 bill just chilling.
Never.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Yeah.
So it sounds like music to your dad, to yourself.
Yeah.
It was just understood. The importance was understood. Maybe to make a full living, but to have exist inside of you. You start to play at bars or restaurants or church or when you were just you, when you're like, all right, I'm going to go do a show. I don't even get. When did that happen?
First gig I ever played, my brother got. It wasn't a paid gig. It was. My brother was going to a local bar next town over, Monticello. It's a place called the Nowhere Bar across the street from the police department. 15, I want to say. And he had talked to the bartender and said, "Hey, my brother is a musician, you know." Because my brother also, Joey, is a musician, damn good one. And the guy goes, "Okay, yeah." And he goes, "Well, can he come in and play here? You know, I heard you have an open mic. Can he come play? Can we play?" He was like, yeah, come Tuesday, whatever it was. And so that was really the first opportunity to regularly go to a bar and play music, really play in front of people on a regular basis, other than something like a camp talent show or something like that, you know, Color Wars.
People that didn't already have an investment in you as a kid, as a human, were watching you play music for the first time.
Yep.
So, like, not aunts and uncles and friends and cousins. It was, like, people that didn't even know you were there are there, and now they're hearing you play music. When you play, do you find acceptance early, or do you find that it's a little more difficult than you thought when it's not your warm family crew?
I think because of youth, you're given an extra 5 points out of 10 right there, right? Oh, man, this kid's great. No, he ain't.
For 15. Yeah.
Exactly. But he's great for 15.
Right.
Right. Exactly. So I was lucky in that regard that there was there's an open mind. We're very forgiving when it comes to people being young, doing anything. It's almost like we're just happy somebody's got a work ethic. Oh, look, they're showing up to work today, yeah. You know? Cool. And so so in that way, I think that was a good, you know, it was good enough reinforcement to keep me going. And it wasn't any kind of embarrassment, you know, because the embarrassment sometimes will get you worse than anything else.
What kind of a student were you at the time, though? Like
decent. I was a good student, you know. I cared a little too much about homework, to be honest with you. In fact, I told my father a couple of years ago. It was after my mom passed, and I saw how much fun my dad could have, you know, once he didn't have someone telling him, take it easy. And I said to my father, I said, you know, Dad, had I known that you were this loose, I would have had a lot more fun in high school, you know. Because, you know, you didn't really want to get in trouble because you get your ass whooped at home, you know. So it was like he had to get permission to do, you know, hey, Dad, you know, this happened at school. Can I disobey the rules to get my honor back? Yeah, sure. Okay. But if you got in trouble without Dad's permission, then, you know,
right,
like for real. I thought that was all healthy, though, to be honest. I never got the belt when I didn't deserve it. And anyway. But he was real loose in some ways growing up, too, because he'd come out and play the bars with us, you know?
Was that fun for you as a kid?
Great. It was awesome. It was absolutely amazing.
So your dad would show up and play with you?
Hell yeah.
You didn't feel like, oh, man, my dad's really affecting my style? Or
hell no.
That's cool.
No, I thought I was lucky, man. I mean, I thought I was lucky. You know, I was getting that kind of attention from my old man, you know? and also that he wasn't trying to curtail my interest in something as unreliable as the arts. He could have said, "Nah, this is stupid, Gavin. This is not where you should be putting your attention."
I mean, especially, you know, because he put his attention there and it didn't work out like he had hoped it.
Yeah.
Because I would think your natural instinct would be, this sucked for me. I want you to know this probably will suck for you, but he didn't do that.
No. You know, prior to me deciding to be a musician for a living, I wanted to go to medical school. I was like, yeah, I'll go to medical school. That's what I'll do. And then here's what happened. 15, I see Billy Joel play. Man, I'm looking around this place. I'm looking around this arena. That was our Christmas present that year. Instead of getting a bunch of whatever, little socks and underwear and all that, they were like, Christmas present this year is going to be Billy Joel concert tickets. We'll go as a family. Cool. All right. We go. I'm looking around this arena, looking at strangers, overwhelmed with joy. They look like they're being cured of whatever was bothering them when they walked in. I know it's not a cure. But I'm saying I got to look around and say, music is medicine. This is an honorable job. This could be honorable. This could be not just a hobby. This is not just a selfish thing to do. Like this really helps people, man. This really speaks to people. And I thought, this could mean something. You got to keep in mind, I grew up in the church, hardcore. We were churchaholics. So, you know, I wanted to make the blind see like Jesus. I was committed. I was going to be an ophthalmologist. And I was, you know, it was in there. But when I saw that, I thought, well, I actually love playing music, and this could help people too. You know, this is cool. You know, sorry, I spit when I talk. So, you know, I just thought this is the right path. This is the path for me.
Is that the bug that bit you right then? As you're talking about it, I'm watching your face kind of. Not just love music, but love the idea that you could do music on a bigger level, not just for yourself, but for others. I mean, I feel like this is the bug moment for you.
Yeah.
When the bug bit you.
That was the moment. Yep. And then there was another reassurance moment when I was about 19. And I had already dropped out of college, I don't know, first or second time. And we went to pay the local garage. A guy named Frank Stratton owned a garage right downtown. We lived 0.7 miles from town. And there was this fella, great guy, Frank Stratton. What a guy. Just a good man, hardworking, good damn man. And we showed up there to pay him. My dad owed him money. You know, you owe people money when you don't have money. But Frank had worked on the car, and I guess Dad got paid. So we want to pay him off. And oftentimes, you know, I remember being with my father many times where he opened his wallet, so he'd say how much, and he'd turn his wallet to me, and he'd turn the wallet so that they couldn't see what he's looking at, but I could see in his wallet he didn't have any money. And he'd say, oh, I just don't have that much on me right now. Can I pay you back, or can I pay whatever? Yeah, yeah, okay. Yeah, no problem, you know, because they're neighbors, you know. It's a small town. So anyway, we pay Frank Stratton, hop in the car. As soon as we start the car, we're just pulling out, and we're about to go over this really short bridge. We had a local lake that was at the edge of town, and the bridge was about 5 foot over the water. And I said, Dad, if you could change anything, what would it be about your life? Without hesitation, he said, I never would have stopped playing music. Now I'm looking at my father, who's about the age I am right now, and I asked him that question. And I thought, he's a great dad for telling me the truth. But I thought, I don't want to feel like that when I'm his age. And he expounded on it. He said, I could have done it. I should have done it. I was good enough. I was good enough to do it. And I quit. And that's what I should have done. I just knew. I said, I want to feel like Dad feels about that. I want to validate Dad. I'm going to validate him. I'm going to validate his talent, you know? And it makes me emotional. Heavy. So I thought I wanted to prove it.
It is heavy, too, especially when we talk about your new record in a second. Because yeah. It is so, you know.
I wanted to prove that he could do it, too.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know?
You want to do it for him?
Yeah.
It almost sounds like you want to do it for him before you wanted to do it for you.
I don't know. But I wanted to validate it, you know? It's important to me. Yeah, it's heavy. But he got to live his dream through me, you know?
You know, the way you talk about your dad, yeah. You can tell it's all the things, love, respect. I mean, the whole list of things whenever you value a human.
Yeah.
And it sounds like your dad was that to you. And, you know, it kind of puts us on the new record here, which, yeah. By the way, I mean, these guys here can attest. I won't say I really like something if I don't really like something. I just go, yeah. Hey, how about that project?
Yeah.
You know, how about that project you did? That?
Yeah, yeah.
The new record is really freaking good. I told you this before we even came in here.
Appreciate it.
That it's like, this is music that I listen to when I just get to listen to music.
Mm.
And, you know, that's how deep this record hit. And that's even before I knew the reason you wrote, recorded, and put the record out when you did.
Yeah.
And so I want to start there. And I rarely want to play a song from the front of the record because then I feel like people go, well, that's just the first song. But Face the River, and that, you know, that's the first track. I believe you sent it to me on, what was the service? SoundCloud. I believe you sent me a SoundCloud link of the record. And so I'm just in the car with my wife. I'm just hitting it, and Face the River comes on. I'm like, God dang, if every song's like this. And it was just one after the other. And
thank you.
Mike, if you'll play some Face the River for me, track one, please.
Try to face the river. And I, all the praise.
What are you singing about there?
I pictured my mother had already passed. My dad was already diagnosed with glioblastoma. I visualized my father looking across the river at my mother. having to face that particular point in his life. It's tough. but But I think that it's material I didn't want to shy away from. I couldn't shy away from it because of the time in my life that I was writing it. You know, watching, you're experiencing these things with these people, watching them go through a stage of their life that we all know is coming at some point. We all have some shared destiny, and I couldn't ignore what I was seeing and just go off in my corner and pretend like there was another world that I could focus on. There was happening right in front of me, you know, even if it's a car crash, you know, you have to see it and know what it is. And, you know, you're hoping that the results aren't going to be as bad as they are, but, you know, it's a car crash. I had to document it. I had to document how I felt and what I thought maybe he felt. You know, art—it's art, man. It's not product. It's art, and it should reflect. It should reflect a real moment in time, and it's called a record, man. You know, a record, a document, a something permanent. We should make a record of where we're at, and have that be so it's known. This is what it was. This is what happened. You know, just the way you look at any piece of history. And then that's what it is.
You put it as track one. It's such a powerful song, and obviously it's the name of the record, and, you know, sometimes the record's named after the track. You know, there's never just a layout of what the order is supposed to be, meaning. Mm-hmm. So that is, if not the most, one of the most powerful songs on the record, and it just, you play the record, first song, boom, punch right in the gut. A beautiful punch in the gut. I mean, that in a way of, like, you emotionally are stung by it. Usually, that didn't happen on track one. Like, why, you went for it immediately. Was there any sort of symbolism there with that?
Well, I think the main thing was, this is a different kind of record. And that was the big thing. It was, you know, just letting the audience know that this is different. It's very different. And I was more preparing them for everything else, you know?
Boy, you did. I mean, and to also hear that story, because this record, not only important because it's music, it's art that you're putting into the world, but... And I know you and I talked about this in a different place, but you wanted to record this record, and have it ready for your dad before he passed away.
Yeah.
And did you have any sort of idea, like, how fast you needed to actually get this done?
No. But I didn't know it was, you know, I knew it was bad. But, you know, there's not ever an exact time, as you know. But it's a limited time, and
was there a rush on you? Did you feel like I got to work fast? It's a timeline that you've got to follow, but you don't actually know where.
Correct, exactly. There's no exact deadline that you're aware of, right? You know, weeks and weeks earlier, he's in the hospital. He says to me, and it was hard for him to talk because of where the tumor was, and he was saying to me. A bit like marble mouth is how he was having to communicate, unfortunately. But he said, you know, I want to hear the music. You know, why aren't you playing me the music? I said, it's not done yet, Dad. I want you to hear it. Like, I want you to hear it when it's right. It's really important to hear when it's right. You got to hear when it's right. I'm, like, really uptight about, you know, my job. And come on, play me something. I'm in the hospital with my sister. And I I said, let me see. I reach out to Dave Cobb. I say, hey, my dad's in the hospital. He's really begging me for these songs. Is there any way just to send me a mix of just a couple of songs? I'd love for him to hear a couple of songs. Just a couple of songs would really help. Yeah, for sure. So a couple minutes later, he sends me three songs. Sends me Face the River and Destiny and Summertime. So your dad starts crying when he hears the first high note of the chorus of Face the River. He's really feeling it right away, you know, really reacting. And, I play him the songs, the three that I had. And he says, I wish your mother could have heard these. I wish your mother could hear this right now, this record. And I says, she wrote the record, Dad. She wrote the record. He says, she did. She did write the record. Some weeks go by. I'm trying to finish the album because I know state is not good. Album is done. I take it to him immediately. I said, Dad, you want to hear the album? The whole album now. He said, yeah. So I put headphones on. Turn it up so I could hear where it's at, you know, loud enough. He likes it loud anyway. And we go straight through the record, top to bottom. And he's so moved. And I said, you want to hear it again? Said, play it for me again later. Let's do it later. I said, good, okay. My brother and I, we hop in the car. We take a drive. A half hour later, half hour after I finished playing that record, phone rings, and my dad's having an emergency. They need to take him to the hospital immediately. There was some kind of complication. And so he's taken to the hospital and put on heavy drugs. And, you know, for the next day and a half, he's just on heavy drugs for that, you know, that slow boat ride out, you know. So however the timing worked out, without exaggeration, got to play him the whole record in the nick of time. And that's a little bit of closure I get. is that I got to give him that experience and say, you know, this is, you know, your dedication, you know. So very hard, but damn, I hate crying.
No, I mean, I appreciate the vulnerability. I mean, you can tell the love that you have for your mom and your dad. You can also tell when you listen to this record. I mean, even if you didn't know why, let's say someone just came across this record on a playlist, not even individual songs, but you may like Gavin DeGraw, Face the River. I think you would listen to this and go, well, something's got him.
Yeah,
like something, because this, it just feels different. It feels like there's
yeah,
it feels like there is, it feels very deliberate in the most beautiful way. And yeah. I want to go to Let Someone In, because again, you start hard, you end hard, and yeah, you know, have all the emotions all in between. But I want to play Mike, this is Let Someone In, track 10.
Let someone in to your heart. Let me in.
But I tell you why this was just a great song for the end. I'm sure you know. I mean, let me just tell you why I think it was a great song for me to listen to this record over and over again. Because it is a very powerful album. But as heartfelt as this song is, it's an upper.
Mm.
This is an emotional set of songs. But Let Someone's an, it's an upper. It's a mid-tempo that makes you feel good. But you know there's some real power behind it. Mm-hmm. And it's that rare mix of all of that. And you're like, man, I just kind of went through something. But I feel good about what I'm about to go through next.
Mm-hmm.
So just there's no word that I can really use except it's just a wonderful project.
Thank you, man.
Even if I didn't know, and I didn't know all the details about why you made, you just sent me the record.
Yeah.
You didn't send me a text and go, hey, it's about mom, dad, and this. You just said, hey, what do you think of this record? And I'm texting back going like, oh, I listened, this is why I listened to my own time.
Yeah.
And I finish it and I'm like, well, I just felt, and now I actually feel like I should go feel some more, but in the most positive way.
Right on. And I appreciate that.
And that song is the perfect close, in my opinion, for this type of record. So
thank you.
Just wanted you to know that.
I appreciate it, man.
I hope you guys check it out. Face the River. It's been out a few weeks now. It is so good.
Wow, thank you.
I mean, it's rare that you get an artist, because it doesn't happen all the time. I think with all artists, at some time it happens, that you can just feel their DNA in the project so much by their influences, what's affected them, what's still affecting them, what their hopes are for the future based on their past. You just feel it all through this, and this is that project for you. And I've been a fan for a long time of a lot of your stuff, but I rarely like the newer stuff from anyone because, you know, when you get to be our age, you like stuff in your formidable years when you're like, all right, I like that the best. It's been the longest, it's proven. But this is, for me, this project is my favorite thing you've ever done.
Thank you, man. Wow. It means a lot.
So
it means a lot. I really tried hard to tell their story, my folks' story and my family's story. I think just watching them go to their daily war on the family's behalf, I just don't feel like that kind of life gets celebrated enough in our culture, you know? I mean, hey, man, we all love sports and music and movies and, but man, you know, I'd rather rock like dad's picture.
Right.
You know what I mean? And because those are my heroes, you know, those are my blue collar heroes, you know, they never even asked me for a thank you.
I think the thank you is you proving it can be done. And you can be somebody else's blue collar hero. I think that's the thank you. I think they knew that and saw that. And I think they're probably thanking you all the time. It just wasn't words going to your ear.
Yeah.
There are many ways to be thanked and to thank folks.
Yeah.
And I think that was there. Man. I got two final things for you. And number one is a little trivial, which I like, though. You went on Dancing with the Stars.
I didn't do very well.
I always like to talk to people who you did it back in 2012. I did the show.
Yeah. Yeah, but you did well.
I did.
You rocked it. I don't want to. Different.
Listen, I won. That's true. Who cares what I did?
Don't rub it in,
Bobby. Who cares what I did? I won.
I got feelings.
What was your general
experience? I got open wounds.
What was your general experience?
Did you hear about my parents, man? Don't hurt me again, Bobby.
With that show, we can keep this quick, but how did you get roped into it? Because I got roped into it.
Oh, yeah.
By the way, love the people there.
And it was amazing.
The experience was, you're training with a pro athlete.
I agree.
Like, you can never do that.
No doubt, brother.
Give me your experience in like 30 seconds on that show.
The experience was killer. I did get roped into it because I like to run motorbikes, and I used to run motorbikes with a buddy of mine who's a lot of fun. He's a race car driver. He's a Red Bull racer, right? So we like to run bikes. I like bikes. And so one day the phone rings. Somebody asked me who I knew was a dancer. Hey, do you want to dance with the Stars? My reply, of course, was what I said to people from One Tree Hill originally, was absolutely not. And my buddy says, why would you say no to that? I said, I don't dance, man. He said, that's the point. And then he said to me, if you do it, I'll do it. I said, really? He said, yep. If you do it, I'll do it. I said, you're wrong. I'm going to get you on a show too. So I talked to the people at the show. I said, I'll do it only if he does it. We're going to do it together. Cool. I signed my contract. I reached out to him. I said, they're sending the contract over. I signed mine. He said, sorry, bro, no can do. Just got a new ride. I was like, I'm going to kill you, bro.
That's funny. It's hard, though. That show's hard.
Oh, it's tough.
It's hard.
Dude, every week I'd get a message from him, say, looking good out there, twinkle toes. I was like, I will kill you, man.
That's funny. The final thing I want to hit you on is, that's funny, is whenever you open for Billy Joel.
Oh, man, Billy Joel, my favorite dude.
I got to think that aside from it being an artist that you just loved listening to and represented where you're from, you know, we have...
Sure.
But you go back to that Christmas. I mean, the first time, 2014 is what it said. Says the first time you opened for Billy Joel. And
yeah.
Did you have any of those emotions the first time you went up to go like, man.
Oh, man.
Like, we came here for Christmas. This is our Christmas present. And now I get to be up here doing this.
Unbelievable full circle moment in life, you know. And I'd met him briefly before, once or twice. I met him because I'd pounded the pavement for so long, for so many years. Before I ever had a record deal, I used to play at a open mic thing, a bunch of Blair studio session guys and stuff. On the Upper West Side, I'd had a gig every Monday night, and after my Monday night gig, I used to go to another place after hours and jam with these guys. And one of them was a sax player named Richie Cannata, who was Billy Joel's early sax player. I put a record out. I got lucky with it. Did good. Richie reached out years later, said, Billy's playing at the Garden. 11 dates or whatever it was. Will you come be my guest? I said, sure. He said, one caveat, sit with my son. He's a fan. I said, I'd love to. Get to the show. Richie texts me, come backstage. Billy wants to meet you. I was like, yeah. So I go backstage. There's Billy. Billy introduces himself. And I was hoping he'd say, hey, I love your music. But he said, I've been reading a lot about you. Thanks. And I said, I'm a huge fan. A lot about you, you know? And I was like, cool. I'm going to go back and sit in my chair now. And then years later, the phone rang. And my dad said, hey, Billy wants you to open for him. And I said, Billy who? Because it had been, you know. He said, Billy Joel, you moron. And I said, yeah, okay, when? He said, this date, that date, this one date. I said, good, where is it going to be? A place called the BB&T Center, South Florida. So I said, great. I go to the gig. I'm backstage. I just get there. Guitar player, Tommy Burns, Billy's guitar player, been with forever, sees me backstage. He said, hey, Gavin, have you seen Billy yet? Billy's here. Have you seen him? I said, no. He said, come outside. we're having a smoke. I said, oh, okay. I go outside. Guys are standing in a semicircle. Billy's in the middle. Having a dragon. I walk out. Tommy says, hey, Billy, Gavin's here. I introduce myself again. I said, hey, man, thanks for having me. He's like, hey, thanks for coming out. You know, thanks for coming. Glad you were able to come here. I said, listen, you're my idol, okay? It's an honor. But I know there's other musicians out there who want this gig. But I want to say, candidly, if you have anyone else in mind for opening for you, yo, fuck that guy. I want this gig. They all start laughing, you know? He said, can you do more dates? I said, I'll cancel dates to do these dates. I'll cancel. You're such a huge influence on me. He was like, you're the guy, you're hired, you know? And he did. And I'm like, man, he gave me a million dates. You know, we played the Garden a bunch of times. I don't even know how many times. You know, Fenway Park, Wrigley Field. I lived around the corner from Fenway Park. When I was in college for about a year, I could never go to Fenway Park. I didn't have money to go to Fenway Park. Then one day I hop in a shuttle bus, hop out of my hotel, get in a shuttle bus, drive through a tunnel, and I get out of a van in the middle of the field in Fenway Park because I'm going to open for Billy that night. And I thought, this was how I was supposed to see Fenway Park. This is so much better. You know?
I don't know, but I can understand how your description of it is. Yeah, I don't get to do that.
Yeah.
I mean, they may give me some free tickets in the outfield. I don't get to do that. You guys check out Face the River. It's just an amazing project.
Thanks.
You know, I'll shut it down here, but at Gavin DeGraw, I can't believe that I bring up El Paso randomly. Just in a comparison to your town and the jails and that had nothing to do with anything.
That's exactly right.
That to me, that's wild.
We're on frequencies, man.
That's wild.
That's it.
That is crazy. I appreciate the time. I appreciate the vulnerability.
Thank you, man.
I appreciate that.
Yeah, sorry I got emotional. I really do apologize.
As you know, you would say the same thing to me if I were to get emotional talking to you. Never be sorry for your emotions.
Yeah, man.
So I'm just going to hold that mirror up to you. Because that's what you would say to yourself.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's funny because you write the song so you don't have to talk about stuff because you have a hard time talking about stuff. So you write the songs because you need to get it out of you, right? But then people ask you about your songs if you're lucky, and you don't want to do the songs a disservice or the people they're about. So you gotta talk about it, and you gotta get it out of you anyway.
And this was the opposite.
It's the way to do it.
Opposite of a disservice. This is such a service. Yeah. Appreciate it.
Thank you, man.
Gavin DeGraw, you guys check out the project, obviously. Another song I love on there is called Ford. Check that song out.
Wow, thank you, man.
Yeah, at Gavin DeGraw. And thanks, man. Appreciate it.
Thank you, bro. Thanks so much.